Hello, assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I am Shilda Ismail and you are watching HRP Live Special in conjunction of World Halal Business Conference WHBC Australia. Okay, in its 14th edition and running, WHBC Circuit Melbourne Australia will be held this 1st till 2nd September at Pullman Melbourne Albert Park Australia. And this WHBC Circuit Australia will be for the first time organized outside Malaysia and hosted by the Ministry of International Trade and Industry Malaysia, MITI Malaysia, and supported by the Australian Trade and Investment Commission, Austrade, and State Government of Victoria, with the team Halal Opportunities in a Borderless World. Okay, for today's HRP Live, with me today is Leonard Ariff Abdul Shatar, Group Managing Director, Duopharma Biotech Berhad. And Duopharma will be joining us in WHBC Australia. Thank you for joining us, Leonard.
Thank you very much, Hilda. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. It's a pleasure to be here today.
Okay. And how are you, Leonard?
I'm fine. I just checked the weather in Melbourne. It's wet, as usual.
Yeah.
And it's actually sunny over here in KL. So looking forward to being there in Melbourne.
Pretty much we at HDC are very, very excited for our first inaugural WHBC outside Malaysia. Okay, let's speak on Duopharma. You'll be speaking on cultivating a dynamic halal ingredients ecosystem control. Wow, okay, that's a mouthful. Perhaps you can tell me, what are the efforts done by Duopharma in implementing sort of like a dynamic halal ingredient ecosystem?
Thanks, Shilda. So let me just put it in context to explain what Duopharma is all about. We're a generic pharmaceutical company. We have been involved in both the small molecule side, is what we call the traditional pharmaceuticals, but we're also involved in the biological side as well. We're the largest pharmaceutical producer in Malaysia. And we also managed to register the first biosimilars in Malaysia as far as the biologicals are concerned. So we've been involved in halal for many, many years. I mean, I've known you for quite a while, Shilda, but it's been 23 years since we got the first halal certification. And this predates the Malaysian Standard 2424, which is the halal pharmaceutical halal standards in Malaysia. We actually started our halal journey 23 years ago under the food category for our vitamins range. And of course, we progressed when the standards changed. We became we got halal with the Malaysian standards. So we always started the halal journey with a few principles in mind. One of which was right at the beginning, we said we didn't want to test for halalness of a product. We needed it to be built into the process. So in other words, we didn't want halal as an afterthought. We wanted halal to be a primary driver in the selection of products, the selection of raw materials, the selection of the process, etc. So that was a major decision, policy decision we made right at the beginning. Then subsequently, we've also started looking at there was a school of thought that said going halal would make the product more expensive. And we managed to disprove it because we do not sell the product any more expensive than our competitors who may not have halal certification. So, the mantra we've used is, halal at no extra cost. So that's involved. I mean, it's easy to say, but it's involved a huge review of our processes, of our raw materials, and working with suppliers as well into Duopharma to make sure they're able to provide us halal certified products. And of course, we work closely with HDC and also the authorities in Malaysia in terms of halal certifications. We work with industry, academicians, theologians, etc. So there's been an incredible amount of effort over the course of the last 23 years in getting this where we are today. And having said that, it's a journey. It's not going to hit an end point. So we continue learning, we continue understanding, and I think more importantly, and this is probably what WHBC is all about, we continue sharing as well, because we need to demystify halal, especially for people not of the Islamic faith, as to what does halal mean, what are the concepts, etc. Because for us in pharmaceutical, getting halal certified was actually, there are two parts, halal, the halal and toyiban side. And you'd be surprised when we went into this, how much we found that the toyiban side and the halal certification was very similar to GMP, you know, good manufacturing practice. So it was not alien to us as an organization to be able to drive the halal agenda throughout the company.
You were saying just now halal at no cost, and you were saying just now, I would like to ask you, I was reading some article with regards to Duopharma, and Duopharma has teamed up with a US-based food tech company called the Live Green Company, some sort like to explore the use of plant ingredient and technology and to replace animal, you know, synthetic. Is this part of the ongoing collaboration to reduce costs, or is Duopharma going forward with a plant-based pharmaceutical product as part of core halal ingredient?
Okay, good question, Hilda. I think the most people get confused. It's actually pronounced Live Green. Okay,
Live Green.
This is an interesting company because we came across them in our discussion with a major funder of the company based out of Boston, the US.
Okay.
And this is part of our sustainability journey. We actually in Duopharma treat halal as part of our sustainability journey. We've set up a board committee that oversees halal within the organization. So the platform of halal extends all the way to the board. But having said that, when we look at sustainability, one of the, you know, we're looking at our carbon footprint in Malaysia. And we were focusing very much, you know, when you talk about ESG, we're focusing very much on the environmental side. And we were looking inwardly about what sort of carbon footprint do we as a business leave. One of the issues that we realized is that if we are going to develop any sort of product moving forward, and one of our pillars is accessibility, we needed to make sure our products were accessible, not just for the Muslim population, but for everybody. And one of the issues we had was in terms of ultra-processed materials that we were using. Was there an avenue where we could replace some of these materials with a plant-based alternatives as opposed to animal or synthetic or ultra-processed in order to make our products slightly healthier? That was one dimension. The other dimension was we do believe that there's a huge amount of interest at the moment in sustainable production as well. And our consumer healthcare business has also been looking at, obviously being a pharmaceutical company, we're very familiar with certain diseases because we supply pharmaceuticals there. But we noticed there are gaps in the market. And one of the gaps that we found was in functional foods. You know, if you are diabetic, you have certain limitations, and we were wondering whether plant-based alternative foods would be, or plant-only foods, would be something that would be safe for the same profile of patients that are already consuming Duopharma products. So Live Green came across our table, and we were looking at it very closely. We had multiple meetings, and they have developed an AI-enabled platform called Charaka, which effectively has almost 25,000 plant characteristics built into it. So we give them a chemical entity, let's say a coloring that we're using that's synthetic. They will then look at the properties that we want, enter into their database, and they'll be able to give us alternatives that can be used to replace those items. We didn't do it from a cost perspective. I think we did it more from a social economic perspective, that our role as a pharmaceutical producer is to make sure our food is as accessible as possible, that we don't exclude anybody in our supply. And we think that plant-based alternatives, whether it's a functional food or as a replacement for some of the traditional raw materials we have, is one mm-hmm. small step towards being more sustainable.
I see. Okay. So the collaboration and the MOU is ongoing, Leonard?
Yes, it is ongoing.
And what is the... Are we expecting any launch of products, new products, innovation, etc.?
Yeah, not so soon. I think you'll probably find on the functional food side will be earlier rather than the pharmaceutical side. Obviously, the governance process around the pharmaceutical food pharmaceutical raw materials is slightly more intensive. So that might take 2 to 3 years before we're able to achieve something. But definitely in the functional food side, there are certain products that Live Green has already developed on behalf of other parties, which they think they can also develop for us. But I think where we're coming from is to tell Live Green, explore what is available in Malaysia from a plant basis, which may be different from something in South America or North America or Europe.
Yeah.
So the value add will come from the ability to develop plant-based or plant-only functional food that is actually developed from locally available agricultural products.
Sourcing from Malaysia and also in Asian countries. Okay, all right.
That's ultimately the plan, because we want it to be sustainable. Obviously, we don't want to create a carbon footprint in importing more raw materials from overseas. And encourage the local agricultural industry to produce certain products. And of course, we still have a way to go, because we still need the ecosystem to process that before we can use it. But Live Green has successfully worked with food companies overseas in terms of developing formulations against taste profiles for that particular market.
Okay. All right. Speaking on halal from pharmaceutical, you know, how do you see this statement in the post-COVID era? What are your opinions to this in terms of business and supplies and demands and consumer needs? Are people, increasing demands, or how does you see the dynamics now?
I mean, the dynamics has actually been quite interesting, because, you know, there was no playbook in terms of how do you manage a pandemic. And there's no playbook to tell you how do you manage coming out of a pandemic. You know, we see demand for air travel higher than what was originally anticipated. And of course, recently in Malaysia, we've had issues about pharmaceutical availability as well, because a lot of the forecast that was done last year for first and second quarter this year, and demand has actually gone much higher than originally anticipated. So there is an adjustment period, not only for the importers of pharmaceuticals, but also for domestic players, to make sure we can gear up fast enough to be able to cater for demand. The interesting thing about what happened during the pandemic is people were more sensitized in terms of their immunity. So we saw a huge increase in immunity-boosting products, the demand for immunity-boosting products like vitamin C. Now, Duopharma is already the largest supplier of vitamin C in the Malaysian market, so we benefited from that. But what a lot of people didn't realize is that during the same period where we were all masking up and taking vitamin C, the cough and cold market actually crashed in Malaysia. There was hardly those companies that were selling primarily cough and cold medications actually suffered. Even our data on our own product, we saw cough and cold come really down really low. Now, if you look back in the last 3 months, suddenly people are masking up less.
Yeah.
They're probably not looking after their hygiene as much as they were during the period of the pandemic. They're not taking as immunity boosting products. So suddenly, the cough and cold market that tanked in 2020 and 2021 has suddenly shot up tremendously. And that also explains why the shortages have occurred. So post-pandemic, I think there's various learnings that we as a manufacturer can see. How sensitive the business is for, you know, I'm hoping somebody will actually do a case study on it, because self-hygiene, wearing of masks, etc., as a normal course of events, will help to reduce some of the needs for some of these medications. Okay. Secondly, I think we had a huge amount of debate about vaccines, yes or no, throughout the period. And I think that's healthy, because to me, it's all about communication, and you will always have alternative views. I don't discount the alternative views, but you know, we should never forget what happened during this last pandemic, because it's certainly not going to be the last one. So I'm hoping that as we move forward, we've learned from the lessons of the previous pandemic, and that we are able to use those lessons for the next time that we have to face the pandemic. Self-sufficiency also became an issue during the period of the pandemic. But, you know, it's always challenging to go for self-sufficiency. You know, countries like Australia, countries like Malaysia, it's challenging because you're talking about a population size of only 32 million. So manufacturing capability tends to be subscale. So one of the thinking that I have is, yes, you can go for self-sufficiency, but you have to be cautious what you do, because we need to make sure that it's sustainable in terms of self-sufficiency. Self-sufficiency in itself may not be viable. So I think partnerships, I hope, will occur. During this period of the post-pandemic, I've been contacted by various Middle Eastern countries as well to see whether, because they have a similar problem, they just don't have the demand sufficient. So I'm hoping, you know, groupings like the OIC will be able to determine, can we develop products to ensure self-sufficiency on maybe a trading block basis rather than individual values. So that's something worth seeing. And I think over time, we'll start developing as well.
Okay, interesting. Leonard, you mentioned just now with regards to the trends, yeah, where we were wearing the mask during the COVID time, during the quarantine time, you know, the coughing, the cough and also cold medication seems to be low, right? So does that mean the consumer demands, the sufficient raw materials to meet the demands of consumers are low, or what are the challenges?
Okay,
do we have the sufficient raw materials to meet the demands of consumers, or you know, how do we go about that?
Okay, I mean, it depends on the company by company. I mean, in Duopharma, we were quite lucky because we tested out by sheer coincidence the ability to do virtual meetings in November 2019. And then in February, we initiated a pandemic response group within Duopharma.
Okay.
Before the Malaysian government actually declared a pandemic, okay? So we decided on a few things. We were sort of brainstorming to see what would possibly happen if a pandemic is called. And even we did not anticipate what would happen.
Yeah.
One of the decisions we made was to increase the amount of raw materials we had, okay? In the event there was supply chain disruption.
Yeah.
So the two areas that we focus on, make sure we have enough raw material, and look at our cash flow very, very closely. So we entered into the pandemic with a slightly higher than normal raw material level. So we saw through 2020 and 2021 reasonably well. We weren't impacted at all based on the demand at that time. Obviously, because cough and cold tanked the market, we had, in fact, even more raw material on the cough and cold market. But luckily, we had also a lot of raw material on the vitamin C market, so we were able to continue producing. So now, suddenly, you have the opposite happening. The immunity-boosting products have more or less tapered, but the cough and cold has suddenly shot up. So at least as far as Duopharma is concerned, we do have sufficient raw material, and we were quite lucky because we actually upgraded our liquid line in the fourth of last year. So we've been able to supply demands in the market. There are certain products where we've had to prioritize because we're also a supplier into the public healthcare system. So we do tend to prioritize the public healthcare system mainly because we have contracts that we have to meet. But the private sector, I think the issue about insufficient products available in the market, I think it's totally transient. My expectation is by next month, everybody would have forgotten that there was that short period of shortage. In fact, I don't even read it in the news anymore.
Me too. All right. Okay. So speaking on WHBC, I understand that you'll be speaking on with regards to the halal ingredient ecosystem. So perhaps you can give a little bit of a gist and core that you would like to advise the participants and also the delegates.
Yeah, I think it's actually the pharmaceutical industry, if I had to draw a parallel, it's a little bit like the aeronautical industry, building an aeroplane. Standards are very, very high, and you have multiple suppliers from around the world in order to make your final product. Okay. That's what the pharmaceutical business is like. So we rely heavily on a lot of companies in terms of, when you punch a blister pack and you see a tablet, all you see is a tablet. But in that tablet, you've got a coating, You've got the active material, you've got the excipients, you've got fillers, you've got all sorts of things that go into that. And then on top of that, you've got the regulatory side in terms of making sure that the product is safe for human consumption. So I think we are coming to a stage where, as I said earlier, self-sufficiency on a per country basis may not be viable because of the size of your population. But we need to look at it from possibly a more regional standpoint. And in that sense, having the WHBC in Australia is interesting because I see Australia having the proximity to ASEAN countries where we probably have on the agenda of the ASEAN meetings or when we have the ASEAN plus one, plus two, plus three, where, you know, where we can develop an ecosystem of supply of raw materials that could be absorbed by our region. Because outside of Indonesia and possibly Thailand and Vietnam and Philippines, which have large population base, the rest of ASEAN actually has very small population base. So in itself, these individual countries are not going to be able to develop an ecosystem of raw materials, etc. But collectively, it's actually quite a sizable block. And you know, at the end of the day, when it comes to providing material, my advice to most manufacturers, and I've said this in other talks I've given, is when you start developing, when you want to open up a factory for raw material, you need to, at the beginning, think about your consumer.
Okay.
You have to understand that the Muslim consumer will insist on halal material. And it's not that difficult as long as you build it into your process before you build your prep factory and decide on your process. But if you try to go for halal post facto, then the problems start. Because I think I say the same things to universities who do a lot of R&D as well. I said, build in the understanding of who your ultimate consumer is, be it Muslim, be it Hindu, or whatever. Try to make sure for these requirements early. So I'm hoping that the message I'll put in also when I speak in Australia is do not need halal as an afterthought.
Yeah.
It's a huge market. You need to understand and appreciate that this will be a key requirement by the Muslim population, not only in Malaysia or Indonesia or Singapore, but globally. So do take that into consideration because you take a lot of other things into consideration. But I notice halal seems to be bottom of the list. And I'm trying to pass the message, let's get it higher on the list and making sure people are sensitized, which is why I participate in a lot of these talks because the whole intention is to sensitize as many people as possible so we don't repeat the mistakes of the past.
Speaking on afterthought, all right, we've been chit-chatting for almost 24 minutes. Leonard, speaking on WHBC, do you think we should be replicating this organization to other countries? And which country or which region would you advise next?
Okay, the short answer to a complicated question is yes. The reason I say that is... I think there's a lot of misconception about halal. I was at dinner only two nights ago with a Caucasian gentleman who'd been in Malaysia for the last 15 years and still had a lot of misconceptions about halal. So I've always believed that communicate, so that you address and take questions, willingly take questions. And if you don't know, just say you don't know. But having said that, I think the concept of halal is not that complicated. It's being made complicated by people who don't quite understand the concept and understand the principles behind it. So I think the more we communicate, the better. Now, in answer to your second question as to where I think... I'm seeing a lot of interest in Korea and Japan, to be quite honest, driven by different reasons. I think in Korea, apart from K-pop, they want to also export their food stuff. Push in Korea to try to get their food by companies like Calbee and a few other companies. And there's a huge amount of interest from Korea in terms of the concept of halal. And more importantly, they're very receptive to it. I saw an increase in Japan, especially as they were preparing for a lot more international conferences, the Olympics, etc., where they are interested to make sure that they are, people will visit Japan willingly, mainly because they have the ecosystem to support different dietary beliefs, etc. So
yeah,
if you ask me, I would say you will have a lot of interest in Korea and also in Japan. And that will be worth considering by HDC as well. So I'll be fully supportive. Love the
Okay. All right. I penciled that thought to replicating HBC in Korea and Japan. Well, that's all we have for this series of HIP Live. And for those interested to be a participant and to hear what Leonard would like to say in his presentation, why not come over to Australia, to Melbourne, Australia, and you can find out about details by our website, which is whbc.hdcglobal.com. We have it on our crawler, and there's still time, and there's still interesting lineups that we can see through these programs. Yeah. Anything that you'd like to say, Leonard, for your last messages for those who like to come to Australia?
I suppose what I'd like to say is, the intention as far as Duopharma and why we participate in a lot of these sessions is to demystify halal.
Yeah.
It's not as complicated as people make it out to be. We've managed to do it for 23 years, so I'm hoping that there'll be quite a lot of manufacturers who will turn up in Australia, or I'm not too sure whether it'll be broadcast online live, but if it does, I'm hoping there'll be a lot more people. And do ask the questions, because we're not going to get, and you're not going to demystify anything if you keep questions yourself. And, as an industry representative, I'm more than glad to share whatever Duopharma has learned over the last 23 years.
Okay, thank you so much, Leonard. All right, that's all we have for HIP Live Special in conjunction of World Halal Business Conference Australia. I would like to reiterate again, for those interested to be a participant, to be a sponsor, do log on to whbc.hdcglobal.com. Do also register as Halal Integrated Platform member by logging on to hip.hdcglobal.com. And for that, I would like to say thank you, Leonard. I'll see you in Melbourne. Okay, that's all we have for HIP Live. Thank you. Assalamualaikum. Thank you so much, Leonard. See you.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikum salam.
The whole world has been brought to its knees from the rapid and destructive spread of pandemic. Including the halal industry. Timely, a digital platform, Halal Integrated Platform under Halal Development Corporation, was established to help entrepreneurs venture into new potential business opportunities and market access. The traditional way of doing business and conducting trade needs major and massive transformation. The halal industry needs a revolution and a holistic approach to bring a comprehensive solution founded on an ecosystem.
HIP came about when we identified that the halal industry at the moment is actually clustered. There's a lot of initiative in halal industry, but it's not unified into one single ecosystem. So having that realization, HDC established HIP so that we can host everyone, all the players from business owners, government agency, financial institution, service provider, consumer and halal professional into one ecosystem in one platform.
As at November 2021, more than 4,000 members and 20 strategic partners signed up. Imagine a train with each carriage representing all elements of industry into one digital platform.
Whoever that want to be part of the halal industry will have this access whereby they can pick and choose what they need in the halal industry through HIP.
HDC's HIP will be the game changer to drive halal exports, facilitating companies looking to grow their business capability and capacity to partake in the USD $3 trillion global halal market. What may have been challenging for local products to be marketed internationally in the past is now feasible. HIP provides various facilities for SMEs to enjoy. Financial, market access, branding, mentoring, and networking. Enabling SMEs to expand their business capability and to be part of global halal industry ecosystem. Newly launched on 9th September, HIP has shown traction.
Within these 3 months, we already deliver impact. For example, we have helped, we have assisted our SMEs, and we have set up recently, we have set up a USD 100 million financial facility for Middle East export. And near future, we will have more and more facility to assist our SMEs. And most importantly, we are through HIP. HDC, through HIP, we are using HIP to help Malaysia to regain back our economy through halal industry.
Memastikan integriti dalam rangkaian halal bukanlah suatu perkara yang mudah. Namun begitu, cabaran yang ada malahan memberi banyak manfaat kepada semua. Kesucian setiap bahan mentah menjadi pilihan seluruh masyarakat. Dimanapun anda berada, Halal Integrated Platform sentiasa bersama anda.
Pembaharan dah nak habis ni.
Ain?
Ya, Bu?
Boleh tolong ibu order bahan-bahan bahulu tak?
Tapi Ain dah nak pergi interview dah ni. Oh, tak apa. Ain bukakan portal HIP untuk ibu. Nanti ibu boleh pilih je dalam ni. Nanti ibu jangan lupa tengok laptop, ya?
Yalah. Ibu selalu doakan kamu berjaya.
Terima kasih, ibu.
Segala akses untuk hub halal hanya di hujung jari anda. Memastikan kelestarian rangkaian hub halal untuk generasi akan datang.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Selamat pagi.
Cepat dia sampai.
Segalanya pantas tanpa batasan. Sebesar impian, segalanya bermula dengan langkah yang pertama. Terukai integrasi tanpa sempadan dan berpeluang kemewakannya kebaru. Budayakan inovasi dan jadikan idea perniagaan anda satu realiti. Lakar kejayaan, catat peningkatan perniagaan melalui HIP. Daftar dan sertai segera untuk berinteraksi dan mendapat akses kepada ribuan pangkalan data. Hanya yang terbaik dari Halal Integrated Platform. Thank you.